Hi everybody, today we are going to discuss about ecology and environment topic. It's an environment topic. So we are going to discuss the basic fundamental level ecology, okay? Because only if you understand the fundamentals, you can build something above it. Otherwise, what you have studied on advanced level without studying the basics will become very much waste. Okay, so let's start with the basics. So ecology, and what is ecology? So we're gonna deal with that first. Before that, just see the table of contents. First one is the first section. We are gonna deal with organism and its environment. The section we're gonna be population, and the third section we're gonna deal with previous year question paper, and the fourth section we're gonna be flashcards. This flashcards means nothing, but we are just gonna revise the entire session in 15 minutes. Okay, so let's start with the first section, that is organism and its environment. Okay, so when we study about ecology, to know about ecology, okay, so we have this four levels of biological organization. So these four levels of biological organizations are organism, population, community, and biomes. So a group of organisms make a population, a group of population makes a group of community, different communities in a similar area makes biome, right? Everyone know the structure now. So we're gonna deal with in detail of each of the sections, okay? So today's session we are gonna deal in detail with the organism level of ecology. Okay, so what is ecology? Ecology, right? Ecology is a study of the biological organization of the four levels, it's organisms, population, community, and biomes. I hope you understood. Okay, so let's go to another next session. So about organism. So what is an organism? Organism, we know, when we study ecology at the organism level. Okay, when we study ecology at the organism level, we are actually studying the adaptation of the organism. We're actually studying the adaptation. So what is adaptation? Adaptation means the survival plus reproduction. Not just mere survival, but the organism must be able to survive and to produce its own offspring in a very good manner in that environment. Okay, so that is what, that is organism level ecology. In the organism level ecology, we are gonna studying about the adaptation of organism, which is not just mere survival, but also reproduction. So what is biome? So you'll be hearing about biome, this, like, you know, we have this biome and all. So what actually is biome that we're gonna study? But before that, in small sense, if we are telling that, you know, there is an environment where there is an organism can adapt and survive and reproduce, then that environment is known as biome. Okay, the environment which is suitable for an organism to survive and reproduce is known as biome. Okay, in the small definition, the fundamental level definition, we have this advanced level definition in the later stages, but for now, just to be in the form of ecology, just learn that biome is an environment which is adaptable for the survival and reproduction of the organism. Now, how is biome affected, or what are the factors on which biome is connected to? There are two main factors. The first main important factor is annual temperature. Annual temperature, that means if the temperature variation differs, the way in which temperature variation comes, the way in which the environment changes, there is variations according to temperature and precipitation. The two main factors which affect the characteristic of biome is annual temperature and precipitation. Hope you guys understood. Okay, now let's delve into biomes. So these are the main biome distribution. As I already said, like, you know, temperature and precipitation. So as I have discussed earlier, there is two main important factors which deals with the biome distribution, right? So which are the main important factors? That is temperature and the precipitation. Okay, when we draw annual temperature on the y-axis and the mean annual precipitation in the x-axis, see the lowest temperature and the lowest precipitation. We see what? Arctic and alpine tundra. This is a biome. Okay, so this biome consists of the area from minus 10 degree Celsius to 2.5 degree Celsius maybe. So this is the area, that means plus the precipitation is very less, right? So precipitation is very less. So we find alpine and Arctic tundra. The other area where precipitation is very less as well as the temperature is very high, that is desert. So you can see in the picture itself. So how a biome changes, right? If you compare a desert with forest, you can know, like, you know, in desert there is very less rainfall and very high temperature. When you compare with temperate forest or tropical forest, very high precipitation and very high temperature, high humidity and all. So this kind of thing will happen, right? So you already know things, right? But you just have to put in the correct perspective. So what is a biome and biome, how it is affected? Biome is affected by temperature as well as precipitation. So now we have this coniferous forest, which ranges from approximately 0 degrees Celsius to 15 degrees Celsius, and the rainfall precipitation from 50 centimeter to 250 centimeter. So this is how we classify each biome. So biomes are classified according to its characters, and each class characteristics, mean, like, you know, rainfall, be it snowfall, be it the leaves, the colors of leaves, etc., are actually dependent upon what? Temperature and annual precipitation. That is why biome is also depending upon annual precipitation and annual temperature. Hope you guys understood. And when we see about the tropical forest, like, you know, from, they have the huge amount of rainfall, right? And maximum temperature also. So that is in the tropical forest area. Let's see, from 150 centimeter onwards, we have this tropical forest. Okay, I hope you guys understood. And actually, you can also clearly, you can actually clearly see the variation, like, you know, from desert, grassland, and grassland to temperate forest, and temperate forest to tropical forest. You can actually see the transitions, right? So this is how actually we are going to study. With this diagram will help you fetch more marks in mains also. So you can just be focused on this diagram. If you can recreate this diagram in answer sheet, it will be very, very much good. Okay, very much good value addition for your answers. Okay, now this is about the biome distribution. Okay, now what is a habitat? What is a habitat? In the same biome, if there is a regional and local variation, then we call it as what? Habitat. Okay, like, you know, the Marustali, Rajasthan, Thar desert, it's a habitat. Marustali is a habitat. Like, this is a permafrost. In recent times, we had heard about the permafrost thawing, right? Thawing. So what is thawing? Thawing is actually melting of this already solidified soil, which has been frozen for years, for 1,000 years or 1,000 million years ago. So this permafrost also is a habitat. Then we have this tropical forest, tropical rain or tropical evergreen forest of Meghalayan forest. These are also what? Habitat. So what is a habitat? If there is a regional and local variation within biomes, that is known as habitat. Hope you guys understood. Okay, so let's start. Let's move into next session. So how are this habitat or how are these organisms affected? These organisms are affected by four main abiotic factors. These are abiotic factors. So these are temperature, soil, light and water. So abiotic factors means what? Which have no living. It is not living. Okay, so it doesn't have any kind of living thing, right? Okay, it's not a living factor. It's a non-living factor. That is temperature, soil, light and water. So when we deal with temperature, we have two kinds of animals, two kinds of organism. One is stenothermal organism and another one is urethermal organism. So this stenothermal organism means the organism who can maintain the stable temperature. Okay, stable, steno, stable. Just remember like ST and ST. It has a stable temperature for a long period. And for urethermal means, it means what? It is a wide, has a wide range of temperature. Organism can maintain a wide range of temperature. Some organism can maintain a wide range of temperature. Some organism can maintain a stable level of temperature. So that is the main thing which is to be studied under temperature. And you know about soil, we know about the pH value of the soil, we know about the nutrition content about the soil. So these are all very, very important when we consider about the soil. Now when we see about light, plants need light, right? So plants need light for photosynthesis. So light plays a major role in plant ecosystem as well as in human ecosystem. In higher level organisms also, light plays a key important role. Now we have this water also, and you know about water, sometimes water even affects the reproduction also, right? So that is one of the major important thing about water. Water, you have one more thing, you know, have stenohaline, same like temperature, they have stenohaline and urehaline. Organisms which can maintain at a haline means what? Salt content. Okay, so organism which can maintain only at a stable salinity in the water is stenohaline, which can vary the salinity, which can change from the, which can actually have the tendency to be in any kind of salinity, have a wide range of salinity ranges for an organism, we know as urehaline. Same as temperatures, stenothermal and urethermal, stenohaline and urehaline. Okay, so that is about. So we have studied about the abiotic factors. Now let's see how the drastic changes in abiotic factors cope with the organisms. Okay, so first things first about homeostasis. So we know that either the temperature decreases or temperature increases, or the soil pH value decreases or pH value increases. So the organism has the tendency to maintain its internal environment in correspondence to the external environment. So we know that when we take an organism, if this is an organism, this organism have its own inner environment. Inner environment in the sense, the inner environment in the sense, the internal organs inside it, the blood level, sugar level, etc. So the organism have its own internal environment, and the organism also have what? Organism also have external environment. So this external environment consists of abiotic factors such as temperature, soil, light, etc. So when we think about the soil, light, etc., often in the case of human being or in the case of certain habitats, it have a tendency to increase its temperature more than its current level, or it has a tendency to decrease from its current state. So what will the organism do? So the organism will try to maintain its internal environment in a constant level. So this property of an organism is known as homeostasis. So homeostasis is, despite varying in external environment, the conditions, organisms try to maintain a constancy of its internal environment. The organism try to maintain a constancy of its internal environment. So it tries to make the internal environment in a state of normalcy. So this is known as homeostasis. So how it is attained, you know, like, you know, if we are in very hot summer, right? Okay, and it's very sunny day. So we always have what? Water with us, right? So what we do, we'll drink water. So as to reduce the dehydration. And we will stay hydrated during the sunny day, drinking water. So drinking water is an artificial mechanism to be in the state of constancy of internal environment. So let's see the natural natural ways in which the organism tends to maintain its homeostasis. So that is regulate, migrate, conform and suspend. These are the four ways in which an organism try to regulate its, maintain the constancy of its internal environment. What is it? Regulate, conform, migrate and suspend. So when we think or when we study about this homeostasis, we must know a graph. Okay, we must just to analyze things, we can use graph. Will improve your marks also in the mains examination. So when we see external level is in the x-axis and internal level in the y-axis. So when this external level at a constant state, the partial regulators, conformers and regulators, these three kinds of organisms are in this constant state. When the external level increases, regulators, what will they do? They also have the tendency to maintain it in the external level. It is doesn't changes, right? You just have to look. It doesn't change its internal level. Internal level remains constant. Example, main example is human being. Next, what we think about next is the conformers. When we take the case of conformers, as how much does the external level changes, as much the internal level changes. So, see, external level increases, internal level also increases. Increases. See, so that is it. And we have partial regulators. In the case of partial regulators, it increases up to a level and after that it maintains below its constant level. So this is about the graph. Just you have to know about it. You don't need to be dwell deep into it. Okay. So let's see how each factors help. First one is regulate. So in case of regulate, one should know that regulate means what? It's a physiological or behavioral change from the part of the organism. For example, we have some organisms are able to maintain homeostasis by physiological, which ensures a constant body temperature, constant osmotic concentration, etc. So a very few lower vertebrate and invertebrate species are indeed capable of such regulations. We will tell that as thermoregulation and osmoregulation. So this thermoregulation means regulation of temperature. Osmoregulation means regulation of the osmotic pressure. Okay, so we know that by evolution many of the organisms have formed. And actually regulation has played a key role in the evolution process. Most plants don't have the process of regulation. Okay, in the case of humans, like we maintain a constant body temperature of 37 degrees Celsius. In summer, when outside the temperature is more than our body temperature, we sweat profusely, right? And as a part of sweating, we come to temperature which is maintaining at the normal temperature. So that is why we are having sweat. Okay, and other ways also when the temperature starts to fall from the normal temperature, we start to do exercises to make heat up the body, right? So these are the things we use to regulate. Human being is the most outstanding example for regulation. Okay, and evolution has become possible mainly due to regulate process. Okay, next one is conform. Conform means we have that we know that 99% animals and nearly all plants, they are conformers. Because the main example is aquatic animals. Okay, in aquatic animals, their body temperature is actually in near to the water temperature. Okay, so they have to make their body temperature changes with the ambient temperature. And osmotic concentration of body fluids change with that of the ambient water osmotic concentration. So if there's a pond, okay, and we have a certain kind of fish only find in that pond, it's because of the osmotic level of the water contained in that pond, which is very suitable for that fish. That is why it is only conforming to that habitat. So that is the main reason why we only see in certain animals in certain place. And we doesn't see small animals in polar, because this is also main reason of conform, because we know big polar bears, penguins, they are animals of huge body. Because of this huge body, a lot of temperature, like, you know, in the surface area, larger surface area means they have larger volume. So this volume tend to absorb heat very fast. And also the, you know, like, you know, blabber is there in we have a fat sheath under the huge fishes. It's also because of the same reason of confirm, because this fat will give what extra layer of burning, fat will burn, so this give more heat. Okay, so that is about the confirm. So nearly 99% of the animals and nearly all plants are confirmers. They can confirm. Okay, so main reason why a very small animal is not seen in polar is because of confirm. If there we see a it's because of that small animals will have small surface area, and this small surface area means small volume, and they are very much attacked by the cold outside. So next, see, migrate. We know everything, right, about migration. So we know birds migrate, you know, butterflies migrate. So migration is actually for what? It's for finding more hospitable area, from a stressful habitat to more hospitable area. So that is what is migration is. So the organisms tend to move from a very stressful habitat to more hospitable area for what? For survival. Okay, so these are all for what? Survival. So survival is the main thing behind the migration. Okay, so this is about the three main things about regulate, confirm and migrate. Hope you guys understood. So what if they are unable to migrate? Okay, one of the main thing is, like, you know, some animals are very, very massive. Some cannot fly. Some are under water and some are under what? Some are under no condition to migrate. So for them, they have their own ways to maintain homeostasis. First one is bear. You all know hibernation. It's in winter. They hibernate in winter to escape in time. Okay, because they cannot bear that harsh winter, not the mild winter, the harsh winter. Next we have the snail and fish. About snail, you know, snail travels very slow, and about fish, they cannot escape from the water. So they, what they do aestivation. This is a snail. Okay, this picture is a snail, and this is a bear aestivating, hibernating. Okay, so aestivation is connected with snail and fish. Bear is connected with hibernation. And about zooplankton, they have a stage of suspended development. It is known as diapause. Okay, it's a stage of suspended development. So when in the period of their growth, there comes a harsh conditions which they cannot survive, what they do, they just diapause. So this, in diapause, there is no development, the stage of suspended development, but they are alive, but they are in a stage of suspended development. So this is about the, if the organism are unable to migrate. Now next, let's see the last but the most important way of maintaining homeostasis, that is suspend. We know about bacteria, fungi and lower plants. So they have what? They have thick walled spores. So these thick walled spores are formed which help them to survive unfavorable conditions, and this germinate on availability of a suitable environment. If we see a fungi, okay, this is a fungi. It has a lot of spores, and this spores, what they do, it's this spore have spores. When look closely under microscope, we can see there is a thick layer of protection. It is because to survive them for in the unfavorable condition to germinate in the availability of suitable environment. That is about the bacteria, fungi and lower plants. In higher plants, we know about seeds and some other vegetative reproductive structures. They serve as a mean to tide over periods of stress. This also help in dispersal, and also it helps to tide over the period of stress. So they, what they will do, when the time, when the right environment comes, when the right time comes, they germinate to form new plants, okay, under favorable moisture and temperature conditions. So this is how, this also known as dormancy. So we know a seed, okay, for example, we know a seed. Okay. So this seed is from a plant, and it was produced in a condition of very desert like condition, and plant is also accustomed to desert like condition. And this seed is actually going, it's flying, it's under many processes, it's going. during those stages before germination, it is known as dormancy. It is actually not germinating. So the stage of dispersal till germination, it's known as dormancy. At that time there is no metabolic activity. When the germination starts, or when they produce new sprouts or new seedlings, then what happens? Then their metabolic activity starts. Up till then they are in a state of dormancy. Okay, dormancy. So dormancy is connected with higher plants, and diapause is connected with zooplankton. So this is about the how the organisms respond to abiotic factors. Hope you guys understood. Thank you for the class. If there is any doubt, please reply.